Well, today we move on to a new section of the course, in a sense. To some extent, we move beyond 1950. So in purely temporal terms, we're now at just past mid-century. So that's part of this, but only part of it, because really what's happening now is that there's a dramatic shift in analytic philosophy. In fact, in some ways, the paper we're about to start discussing today, empiricism and the philosophy of mind, is something that a lot of people would think kills off analytic philosophy, at least in the sense in which it was originally conceived. One way of thinking about this is to think about the heroes of the movement. In the early stages of Frege, and then especially Russell, and Moore, and Carnap, and so on, there is a very clear hero. The hero from the history of philosophy is Hume. Okay, and people see themselves as carrying out a kind of Humean project. Admittedly, taking what is psychological in Hume and turning it into something logical. So psychological empiricism becomes logical empiricism. But still, Hume is the figure who really inspires people. Hume went throughout much of the 19th century in low repute. He was not considered a major philosopher. But his reputation revived dramatically in the early part of the 20th century. And suddenly Hume became one of the key pantheon figures in Western philosophy. You know, if you think, who are the great figures of Western philosophy? Who would they be?
Kant.
Who else?
Plato, Aristotle.
Plato, Aristotle? Yeah, after that it gets harder, right? They're more competitors. Who after that?
Hegel.
Hegel? Good. Who else?
Descartes?
Yeah, well, you're supposed to say, oh, and Hume, right? At least you're sort of like these 19th century figures who were thinking, yeah, Hume, he's one of these minor empiricist figures. But all of a sudden, his reputation gets a huge boost. And correspondingly, the reputation of the anti-Humeans, and so especially of Hegel, drops dramatically. But around mid-century, people begin to realize that the empiricist project has all sorts of problems. And we're going to look at a number of dimensions of those problems over the next several weeks. But Sellars' paper is a crucial milestone in recognizing those problems. And Sellars writes his first book, actually, on Kant, and then later writes a paper in which he entitles, there's one entitled Meditations Leibnizians, but also one that is really inspired by Hegel. And many people think of this work, Empiricism and the Philosophy of Mind, as injecting, you might say, a huge dose of Hegelianism into analytic philosophy. So it really changes the course. You might say, early on, the hero is Hume. Then around mid-century, with other people that we haven't really talked about much, but Gilbert Ryle would be one example, P.F. Strawson is another, Kant enjoys a revival. And then Sellars begins and encourages that Kantian revival and actually brings back Hegel into the discussion. So it does transform this paper. It transforms the course of analytic philosophy. Well, the heroes are just one indication. What is this paper really about? Empiricism and the philosophy of mind. Well, it's about empiricism. But it's about a certain view that it's really trying to undermine. What is this paper attacking? I'm not surprised that you're sitting there, partly because it's a really difficult paper to read, but partly because it's not really very clear exactly what the enemy is. This is a paper about the myth of the given. And so in some sense, it's this idea of the given that is under attack. On the other hand, what exactly is the structure of the theory being attacked is not always clear. What thesis is being attacked is not always clear. What the argument is not always clear. So let me see if I can help you out. Sellars was himself the son of a philosopher. Roy Wood Sellars was a prominent American philosopher who taught at the University of Michigan for many years. And he was best known for being a critical realist, somebody who believed that there was a real world independent of the mind, and so in that sense was an opponent of the idealists, but also was rejecting what he saw as the naive realism of people like, in some incarnations anyway, G.E. Moore and others, and trying to say, yes, there is a distinction between the world as it is, and it really does exist independently of mind, but we construct representations of it, and we have to be critical about those representations, because sometimes we get the world right and sometimes we get it wrong. Now, all of that sounds pretty commonsensical, But that was, in a sense, Sellars' background. He grew up in Ann Arbor around philosophers discussing these kinds of issues. He went to study at Oxford, but never finished his PhD. He was working on a dissertation on Kant when World War II interrupted his studies. And as happened to a number of people around that time, at the end of the war, he just got a job. People realized the war interrupted everybody's plans and didn't really require them to finish their dissertations. So he ended up teaching at Iowa, then at Minnesota, then at Yale, and then at Pittsburgh. So what was the idea that he's addressing here? And more broadly, it goes back, in a sense, all the way to Plato in the Theaetetus. Plato considers the following possibility about knowledge. He says, what is knowledge? Maybe knowledge is perception. Well, that's not right. Knowing something is not just seeing it that way, right? Why not? What's wrong with just saying knowledge is perception? Knowledge is seeming. Being green, in the framework of this essay, is just looking green. What's wrong with that? Well, I've already said to you, the walls of this classroom look green to me. But most of you think I'm crazy, and they're not green. So this is a perfect example for today. You could say, look, that idea that knowing is perceiving just makes it impossible to be wrong. If it looks that way to me, then it is that way for me, right? Then I know it's green. But we make mistakes all the time. So it looks like that can't be right. Then Plato says, well, okay, what if instead of just perception or even opinion, knowledge is true opinion, an opinion that actually gets it right? What's wrong with that?
You just happen to be right.
Good, you could just happen to be right. I say, hey, do you think there's life on other planets? You might say, yeah, and it turns out you're right, but that doesn't mean you know it, right? You're just sort of lucky. Or I say, who's going to win the Super Bowl next year? And you say, Patriots. Actually, because the Patriots always win the Super Bowl. could be, but you know, if it turns out you're right, we don't, for that reason alone, say you know it. Maybe you're somebody who knows nothing about football, except you heard about this Tom Brady thing, and so you say, oh yeah, Patriots, because that's the only team you know. Okay, so anyway, knowledge can't be said to be just true belief. It's not just perception. And at the end of the dialogue, he says, well, what if it's true belief with an account? It's justified true belief. And that sounds pretty good to everybody. That solves these problems. Well, except for the fact that Plato says, wait a minute. In justifying a given belief, like the Patriots will win the Super Bowl next year, I have to appeal to certain things, right? Other things that I presumably know. But how do I know those things? They must have justifications. And how about those things? They must have justifications. And so I get this picture of knowledge that goes back. And now he says, do you mean at the end, all of this rests on some foundation of things that I know, but on the other hand, I have no further justification for? It looks like either I go on justifying things infinitely. And if anybody's ever had been around a 2 or 3 over, you sort of know what this is like, you know. Oh, it's going to be a nice day today. Why? Well, because, see, there aren't any clouds in the sky. Why? Well, there's not that much moisture in the air. Why? And eventually you just say, oh, shut up, right? Or because I said so, or whatever. But, you know, it's sort of like that. You can keep asking why, and if it doesn't go down infinitely, in which case you never finish your justification, the idea is at some point it has to be stopped. But then those things are known without being justified, and so Plato leaves you in the end of the dialogue with a problem. Ooh, well, if knowledge is justified but true belief, it rests on a bunch of things that are known but not justified. Problem. And he doesn't really propose solutions there. The traditional solution is to say, actually, there are several possible solutions, but one traditional solution is to say that at the end, well, these things justify themselves. They're self-evident, okay? So we get a picture like this. A sort of layer cake, a theory of knowledge, you might say, in which a variety of things we know are justified in terms of other things we know. And eventually we get down to some things that are really basic, that are in the foundation. These things we might say are given. Now, what are those things? Well, let's say that they are things that are the most basic kinds of knowings. Okay, they are, if you want to think of it this way, inner episodes, mental episodes. They are knowings. However, They're the most fundamental kind. There is no further justification of them within the realm of knowledge. Let's call these things graspings. They don't really have a clear name in the literature, but let's just call them that. This whole thing is a picture of what we might call foundationalism. It says that knowledge rests ultimately on a foundation. Okay? And where do we get these graspings? Now, what would be at the foundation, by the way? That's a good question. What are things that might be viewed as self-evident?
Analytic truths.
Some of them might be analytic truths, exactly. Some of them might be logical truths. But if we're talking about empirical knowledge of the world, presumably that's not analytic, and it's not something that's logically true. So what could be the foundation in terms of graspings, these ultimate sort of basic knowings, when we're thinking about empirical knowledge of the world?
Physical laws?
Well, some might be physical laws, but gosh, I mean, if I say, oh, well, all of this depends on equals mc squared, you're going to say, wait, how do you get that? That's not like something that's foundational. That's something that presumably requires lots of justification. And so we want these to be things that just, you know, aren't subject to experiment, aren't subject to further justification or argument, are just kind of the most basic thing. Not basic in the sense of sort of overall structure of our empirical knowledge in the way that scientific laws might be, but instead basic just from our own perspective. Yeah?
Just basic sense data, like kind of what Russell does?
Yeah, exactly. At the time Sellars is writing, the most plausible candidate for this is Chisholm's theory of appearance. And so it's looks statement. Things like, that looks green to me. Now, at any rate. That becomes something that would be taken here. Or, I'm being appeared too greenly. This type of thing. But yes, it would be something that is very basic about the appearances as they present themselves to me in sensation. And so that tells us, well, either this is the most basic thing, or really that it rests on a structure of sensation, where these now things aren't really beliefs, but they're perceptions, right? So think of all of these things as beliefs, but think of these down here as sensations. And in fact, let's call these basic ones sensings. Okay, they are things that underlie these graspings. So I say, the wall looks green to me. Actually, even the wall is already building in certain structures. So just that looks green to me now might be something that is a grasping. And what does it rest on? My sensation of the wall. Okay, in this case, a visual perception of the wall. Now, we might try to frame a theory about how all of this goes. And so what would it look like? Well, so far, we've only said a couple of things, really. We've said there are these two kinds of things, graspings and sensings. And we might say, what's really important about them? What makes these fundamental in a way that something like E equals mc squared, or there are many desks in the room, and so on, are not fundamental? The thought is these are basic because they don't presuppose. Well, let's start with the sensings. They don't presuppose any concepts. There is a distinction in Kant between sensibility and understanding. Sensations are over on this side, you might say, or really in the five senses. And then understanding is where concepts sit. So we might think this is all what Kant would consider understanding. And what's distinctive about that? Well, all of those things involve concepts in some way. But down here, this is what Kant would consider sensibility. And these sensings, the idea goes, really don't involve any conceptual abilities. Or at least they don't presuppose any conceptual abilities. And the thought is, there's a sharp line between those. Now maybe you can see why I said this paper is alien in its spirit. Hegel does many things, but one of the main things is to attack Kant's distinction between understanding and sensibility. to say, actually, concepts and sensations are interwoven. There is no way to say, ah, here are the perceptions I have about the world, and then here are the concepts I use to organize the perceptions, as if those are two different things. In Hegel, they're all mixed together. Okay, we already come at the world with a set of concepts, and we organize experience in terms of those concepts, and there's no way to isolate the part that is sort of purely preconceptual from all of the rest. So that's exactly what Sellars is going to try to do here. What is the relationship between these graspings and these sensings? Well, the thought is there's really a twofold relationship. There is a causal relationship. I might think the wall looks green, for example, because I sense it in a certain way. But also, I can justify, or attempt to justify anyway, these graspings in terms of the sensings. If you say the wall isn't green, I can say, but look, doesn't that look green? And you might say, no, it looks gray. Or yes, it does look green, or something. But anyway, there is a relationship here that is also a relation of justification. Let's put this in terms of a few theses. First of all, let's think about these sensings. The idea is that the sensings are these inner episodes of perception that don't presuppose any conceptual capacities at all. Okay? They're purely preconceptual, purely sensation. There are no concepts. Now, I think as soon as we look at things we're used to looking at, it is true we're automatically thinking of them in terms of concepts. You walk into a room, you recognize that as a room. You see seats, you see a clock on the wall, you see blackboards, and so on. And so you're immediately categorizing things. But imagine looking at something unfamiliar to you. Let's say, actually, this isn't that hard to imagine. Go to something like the Museum of Modern Art and look at a canvas. And you might say, okay, I categorize that as a painting, but now look at the painting itself. It might be very hard to categorize what's going on in it. In a traditional painting, it wasn't so hard. Still life, oh, pears in a bowl on a table, right? And you're automatically using concepts to understand what that painting is about. Oh, or it's a portrait of Lady Grey or whatever. And you recognize that as a person. But if you look at an abstract canvas, you may not know how to categorize that, right? Yeah, I'm trying to think of some of the art on this campus. There's that thing with all the canoes, right? When that was first put in, actually, UT, I'm embarrassed about this, I shouldn't say this, but on the Facebook page, UT was bragging about this. Oh, look at this beautiful sculpture, blah, 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 blah. And I just said, my comment on it, unequivocally hideous. I've actually learned to like it better. The more I see it. But why have I learned to like it better? Because initially I thought, what the heck is that? Somebody strung together a bunch of canoes and hung them in the air. I thought, that's ridiculous, okay? It reminded me, in fact, of the artist that was hired by the Hartford City Council to do a sculpture in downtown Hartford, right beside the old historic church. And they just brought in a bunch of boulders and dumped the boulders there, and then did nothing. So several months later, the city council said, well, where's the sculpture? You had the stuff delivered, but come on. You know, we expected you to actually construct the sculpture. And I said, that's it. Just random boulders. I don't think it's still there. But anyway, some works of art. Now, actually, eventually, the trees around that thing grew up. I started seeing, oh, this is like a tree made of metal. The canoes are supposed to look like branches of a tree. But notice what happened when I got this greater appreciation for it. I categorized it in some way, right? I classified it. But at first, I couldn't do it. I didn't have any concepts that went with this, and I thought, unequivocally hideous. Then I started acquiring some concepts, like, oh, it's supposed to be like a metal tree. Hey, okay. And so I've moved from there to, Now, when I look at it that way, I can suddenly make sense of it. So in short, I think we can get the most sympathy that we can for this view that there's a sharp line between understanding and sensibility. When we look at something we don't understand, when we look at something and say, what the heck is that? okay? Another nice example, the other night there was a 20s murder mystery party. My wife and I went to this murder mystery party and dressed up. She was in a flapper dress and I was wearing this black suit with a white tie and a black fedora, trying to look like a gangster and so on. It was all set in Chicago. Well, anyway, it was fun, but I was, you know, we were taking pictures because I'm like, yeah, we don't normally look like 1920s gangsters. And anyway, I don't know what happened in one of these photographs, but it was like two photographs got superimposed on one another. I know how that happens in a film camera. How it happens digitally, I don't understand. But all of a sudden, it was kind of like my wife's face was superimposed on itself with a cat, too. So it's kind of like half of my wife's face, other half of my wife's face, the butt of a cat, sort of all stuck together. And initially, you look at the photograph, you're like, what's going on in that photograph? It was like looking at some weird cubist painting. And indeed, when you look at a weird cubist painting, right, you sort of say, oh, I don't know what's happening here. What's going on? And so that's a good indicator, if you want to think of it this way, that there really is this line to be drawn. Sometimes we just look at things and we say, I don't know how to categorize that. I've got no concepts for this. In any event, that's what motivates drawing this line. And so the thought is, yeah, we might say there's a thesis. Let's call it the sensation thesis. And it just says that some sensings, or some sensations, let's call them sensings, presuppose, instead of saying all the time conceptual capacities, as Sellars is inclined to, I'm going to just say presuppose no concepts. Make it a little simpler. But okay, that really just says, look, there are certain sensations that really are preconceptual, that are independent of all that. Now, there might be others that aren't. You walk into the room, you immediately recognize there's a room full of people. And concepts are already in play the moment you walk in. You don't sort of think, well, what is this? Oh, room full of people, okay. In the way I look at that sculpture and I think, what is that? And then, oh, it's a metal tree. So, canoe tree, yeah, it's a weird concept. Anyway, think of it that way. There are these sensations. And then, let's have one about graspings. Or, let's call these non-inferential knowings. So a grasping is one of these basic items of knowledge. It's not inferential. It doesn't come from other things we know. It doesn't come from other beliefs. So it has no further justification within the realm of belief. It's non-inferential. Like, the wall looks green. I just say, look, it just does. I'm not inferring that from anything else. It just looks green to me. And somebody else who says, no, you're wrong. The wall is gray. It looks gray to me. They are, in a sense, also knowing this, or if they do know it, non-inferentially. Actually, most one of us can know it, right? Presumably, well, I don't know. What do we say about borderline cases where it's sort of green, sort of gray? Does either one of us know it? I don't know. But in any event, that's an interesting sort of question about what we do about vague boundaries. Yeah?
So if all knowledge is based on these graspings that only come from sense experience, is there any objectivity in this worldview? Or is everything kind of subjective because it's just based on your sense data?
Oh, well, all right. How do we get objectivity out of this? Everything rests on the sensings, but we then have to think, well, some of these sensings and some of these graspings have a kind of authority, okay? But what do I mean by saying they have a kind of authority? Well, I might mean a bunch of things. I might mean that they actually correspond to the way the world is, if I'm a realist. I might just mean they actually correspond to what other people say. And so I say, my shirt is blue. And other people say, yeah, it is. So you can recognize some colors, even if you're wrong about the walls. And those things are, then, okay, good. So some things, in short, in this picture, the way Sellars is thinking about this, and the way that a lot of traditional foundationalists think about this, there are these private, subjective states that underlie everything. And yet we ultimately recognize certain things as objective because we get to the point where we can endorse them. Now, what's involved in that endorsement? Maybe it's a question of matching it to the world, And sometimes it's just a question of having our sensations cohere in the right way, either with our own further sensations or the sensations of other people. So with color perception, I might actually say, well, all right, that looks green to me. And you say, no, it's not green. This looks blue to me. And you say, yeah, good on that one. This book looks red to me. You say, okay, yeah, I'll grant that. And so on. And so I endorse things because other people agree. Or some things, it's a question of my further perceptions. I say, the law of gravity tells me that if I drop the book, it will fall. Let's see what happens. It did fall. Gravity confirmed again. Tell the physics department. The probability has increased. Yeah, that's a joke. Anyway, so it might be that there's a kind of coherence there that leads me to feel that I'm justified in endorsing this as objective. But you're absolutely right to say on this picture, it is problematic how I get from something that is purely private, as these are, to something objective. Now, it's actually worse if I erase this line. Why? Because I might think that our faculties of perception are pretty similar, right? My vision is pretty similar to yours. Now, not exactly. Some of you, for example, might be colorblind. Almost all of you probably have better vision than I do. I take off my glasses and I see blobs, but probably you don't. Some of you don't wear glasses, and some of you, if you took off your glasses, would see things more precisely than I do. And so that indicates there are some differences, but we think we can categorize those differences and understand them. Yeah, sound, people can be, you know, they can hear at varying degrees of precision, and some people are utterly deaf. What about smell? We don't really have much of a language for smell, so it's hard to say to what extent my sense of smell corresponds to yours. Touch, we probably have somewhat more. What sense am I leaving out?
Taste.
Oh yeah, taste. Well, taste, right. We have some language of that, and in some cases a highly refined language, and yet people have different tastes about various things, so it's hard to... So anyway, there's not a precise correlation between my perceptions of things and yours, my sense faculties and yours, and yet we think there's enough similarity that, you know, it's not the case that I see something as a circle and you say, oh no, it's a square, and you're really accurately reporting your own sensations. So there's enough correspondence that we end up thinking at least that intersubjective agreement is a kind of proxy for objectivity. But I think it's a crucial question and one we have to keep in mind because it affects this, not only the entire picture under attack here, but also the position from which it's being attacked. Erasing the line just makes it worse because now it's not just if you have different sense organs from mine, now it's if you have different concepts for organizing your sense organs. If there's a sharp line here, we can distinguish those things. But if there isn't, then actually the sensings and the conceptualizings and the graspings and the knowings all blend together into this mass. So it's very hard for us to evaluate objectivity across conceptual differences. So think back to what the connection is supposed to be here. These sensings are a necessary condition of the graspings. I can't grasp something empirically if I don't have any sensation on which to rest it. So understand all of this as being about empirical knowledge. Of course, analytic knowledge or logical knowledge might be in a different category. But suppose we then say, okay, sensings are necessary conditions of graspings. We might think of that as a key empiricist thesis. Or you might say, look, that's just the definition of empirical knowledge. But the thought is really, no, this is something that is pretty fundamental to empiricism. After all, a lot of rationalists would think that we do have graspings of self-evident truths that are not just analytic or logical, but really about the world, on the other hand, don't have anything to do with sensation. Things like all men are created equal, for example, or what are some other candidates of self-evident truths in the philosophical tradition? Kind of thing that a rationalist says. So we do have synthetic a priori knowledge, namely
causation.
Yeah, maybe every event has a cause. Things happen for reasons. Maybe truths of mathematics, 1 + 1 = 2. 7 + 5 = 12 is Kant's famous example. Yeah, I don't know why he didn't just do 1 + 1 = 2. Like, yeah, it's a little too easy. Let's make it 7 + 5 = 12. I don't know. In Augustine, it's 7 + 3 = 10. So somehow they always want the answer to be, you know, double digits. There's an episode of The Simpsons where Homer is introduced to this guy who is this math genius, you know, one of these, what do you call somebody who can come up with these complicated mathematical answers but doesn't really know how they do it?
Savant.
Yes, anyway, he's introduced to the savant. The guy says, you know, ask him any arithmetical question at all. So Homer says, what's 12 plus 27? The guy says, 39.
Whoa.
Anyway, all right, so sensings are necessary conditions of graspings. And then we could say, graspings, in turn, are the foundation for all the rest of empirical knowledge. And so we might say graspings are necessary conditions for all empirical knowledge. And so far, I've really just written down in language what's already implicit in our diagram, but I just wanted to spell it out precisely. Now, nothing, as far as I can see, in Sellars' essay actually challenges any of this. In fact, we could go further than this and add one other claim, which we've got here. It's not just that these sensings are the causes of graspings and are necessary conditions in that sense. Also, they play a role in justifying. And so we can add that. We can say graspings, well, what do I want to say? Do I want to say this about sensings and graspings? I guess. Sensings play a role in justifying graspings. And so in that sense, in justifying all the rest of our empirical knowledge. Now notice I say they play a role. I don't want to say they just are justifications, because a lot of people think only a belief can be a justification and a sensation isn't a belief. But partly also because analytic knowledge, logical knowledge, all sorts of things enter into inference besides just these sensing. So they're part of it, they're not the whole picture. Even for the graspings, you might say, in order to know that that looks green to me, I've got to have a certain set of concepts. That does involve some conceptual ability. These are non-inferential. We don't infer them from other things, but they do involve concepts. All of this is part of understanding, and so involves conceptual abilities. And so those concepts are going to be involved as well as sensings, at the very least. Well, let's call all of this. It'd be nice to give these theses a name, and that picture a name. And so, as we've done it so far, we can call this the immediacy theory, or the given, the theory of the given, okay? And really, all of those five things, I think Sellars is willing to accept. That's not what this essay is actually about. Part of the reason I've laid it out this way is because I think it's very easy to see this, and in fact, a lot of people do see this as an attack on that sort of picture. But if so, it's an attack on very specific aspects. It's not on the whole picture itself. And so there would be a way of reading Sellars where you just say, oh, this is kind of like the Quinean web of belief stuff. Science confronts experience all together. And so actually there's no way to single out the contribution of this from the contribution of that. So it's all mixed up together. So we've got this web of belief. This is just more of the same thing. But I don't think it is. There's something different going on. And so part of our job today is to figure out what it is. So, let's take a look at the essay. I presume that no philosopher who has attacked the philosophical idea of givenness, or to use the Hegelian term, immediacy, has intended to deny there's a difference between inferring that something is the case, for example, and seeing it to be the case. If the term given referred merely to what is observed as being observed, or perhaps to a proper subset of the things we're said to determine by observation, the existence of data would be as non-controversial as the existence of philosophical perplexities. But of course, this just is not so. The phrase the given, as a piece of professional epistemological shop talk, carries a substantial theoretical commitment, and one can deny that there are data or anything that is in this sense given without flying in the face of reason. So he ends up attacking what he calls the framework of givenness. And part of what we've been trying to do is figure out what that framework of givenness is. Now, I think it includes all of these five things. But it seems to me that actually what he's concerned about isn't these five yet. What is controversial in this essay? What is he really trying to attack? It's a hard thing to answer. And so that's why I've tried to spell it out and do a lot of talking today. Next time we're going to look at some of his arguments and do much more back and forth, I hope. But to see what's at stake, we have to realize it's not quite this yet. It has to do with, in part, with the structure of these things together. In other words, if we just look at the layer cake and the various levels and the relations of the levels, I don't think there's that much in this essay that actually attacks any of that. We have to look inside. What is this realm of graspings like? And again, empirical graspings. Let's push aside anything analytic or logical or whatever. Well, it's going to look like things like, that looks green. This looks black. That looks white. This looks blue to me. The chalk smells chalky. etc. My hands feel slippery from the chalk. Etc. It's going to be things like that. Now, you're going to have your own set of these things, how things look to you, how they smell to you, feel to you, etc. How do those relate to one another?
Individually, or?
Yeah, how does your, the wall looking however it looks to you, the blackboard looking however it looks to you, etc. How do those things connect to one another? Yeah, you're looking at me puzzled because at first glance it doesn't look like there is any connection, right? I mean, that looks green to me. The second hand of the clock looks red to me. You might say, ooh, what's the relation between those? They're complementary colors. Interesting. But I don't think anybody planned that. Nobody looked at the second hand and said, oh, this room's got to be green. and so it looks like these things are just independent of one another, right? So we can think, in addition to all this, we could have a thesis of independence. I'm going to just call it atomism, because I think it's a key part of the logical atomism of Russell, for example, and Wittgenstein, that if we look inside this realm of graspings, they don't presuppose any other empirical knowledge. Maybe they presuppose something about concepts, but they don't presuppose any other empirical knowledge. So graspings are independent, you might say. They presuppose no other empirical knowledge. Now, in a sense, there are two aspects of this. One is something that really does have to do with the structure of the picture. We're putting them on the bottom and saying, these presuppose those, these don't in turn presuppose those. And so we're partly justifying our layer cake picture, saying that they're at the bottom there isn't a further dependence that goes in the other direction, but partly we're also saying within this realm there aren't any interdependencies. These graspings are all independent. Okay, they're all atomic, and they're just little atoms, you might say, that contribute to our understanding of the world. Now, what is the relationship between those and the rest of empirical knowledge? Well, Sellars frames it this way. They are the ultimate court of appeals for all empirical knowledge. They are the ultimate justifiers, or the ultimate underminers. All the credibility of empirical knowledge depends on their credibility. So I'm going to call this adjudication. Graspings are the court of appeals. Now, sometimes it's very direct. By the way, today I'm doing something weird. I'm starting on the right and going left. It's like I spent my weekend reading Hebrew or something. Anyway, but yes, the thought here is, suppose we're having an argument about something. Ultimately, it comes down to these graspings. Our fight might be up at this level. Let's say we're having a philosophical argument. That's very far from experience. But ultimately, you might say, it depends on certain things. It rests on some of these graspings. And in the end, that's the Court of Appeals, just what is our experience of the world like? If we're trying to understand scientific truth, for example, how do we figure it out? The ultimate Court of Appeals is just experience, the results of observation, the results of experiment, the things that are these basic knowings built on our experience of the world. Yeah?
So what would that say about things like the absolute is lazy?
Yeah, what would it say about something like the absolute is lazy? That's going to be a highly theoretical statement, right? I mean, lazy isn't that far up the cake, but the absolute's really high above the cake. And then we're going to say, okay, good. What difference does that make to these graspings and to the sensings? If it has any empirical content, presumably it makes some difference. Now, Sellars thinks of himself as very far, in a sense, from that logical empiricist tradition. But I think you've put your finger on one way in which, at least on this picture that we've been outlining, there is a connection. After all, in one sense, well, look, the graspings are necessary conditions for all empirical knowledge. So if you could at least be in the position to know that the absolute is lazy, or anything else about the absolute, for that matter, it must ultimately be that there are certain graspings that are connected to that. On the other hand, this adjudication thesis would say something much stronger. And it would say something like theological empiricists wanted to say, that in the end, the content of that is going to really come down to something like, well, I shouldn't say the content has to be identified with the way in which it might be adjudicated in that court of appeals of experience, but it's going to have to be connected with it somehow. We'd have to be able to settle whether that's true or not on the basis of experience, and so we'd have to have some way of doing that. Now, Sellars' essay is meant to attack this and to attack this, and so he's not endorsing these claims. He's seeing this as part of the overall picture and the part that he wants to attack. But the reason I wanted to isolate them is to say, look, he's not really denying that there are such a thing as graspings, these non-inferential knowings. He's not denying that there are sensings. He's really saying that the structure of them is much more interwoven with themselves and that they're interwoven together much more. And so in particular, graspings are going to turn out to presuppose quite a lot on his picture. And they are, moreover, not really going to be the ultimate court of appeals. Or, this is such a vague metaphor, it's actually hard to say in the end whether he rejects this or not. But for the kinds of reasons you're thinking about, he's going to say, the picture that that he feels that he's inherited from the logical empiricists, he thinks is misleading in this regard. Now, there's one other thesis that I think is maybe under attack here, but we'll get to it in good time. So those are the main ones. And as I see it, these are the main targets of this paper. So is there a positive way of putting this? Well, he's denying that graspings presuppose no other empirical knowledge. So if we want to turn this into positive theses, here's one. It will be that graspings, non-inferential knowings, called these graspings, presuppose other empirical knowledge. So, for example, well, we're going to talk about this example in detail, but that looks green to me. What does that presuppose? What kind of empirical knowledge?
Is that what green looks like?
What green looks like, exactly. And under what conditions it's appropriate to actually figure out what green looks like. These conditions are pretty appropriate, granted, if these lights at least are fairly accurate about color, but suppose I do this. Now, what color do the walls look like to you? You might think, I can't tell you, because these aren't the proper conditions for evaluating color perception. And so I've got to know what green looks like. I've got to know what are appropriate conditions for judging whether things are green. And in short, there's all sorts of other empirical knowledge that's going to be presupposed. So he's going to give us an argument to that effect. The second thing, let's take this denial of the adjudication thesis graspings aren't the ultimate court of appeals. Well, that sounds pretty negative. Is there a way of making that positive? Is there such a thing as the court of appeals for empirical knowledge? And is it something else? In the end, he's going to say something like this, to give you an indication of where this is going. Science is a self-correcting enterprise. Its value is in its ability to self-correct, but it's not as if it really rests on any court of appeals at all. So this picture of knowledge as resting on experience, as a building on a foundation, is really not the right picture. Science is this thing that takes a body of experiences and then tries to systematize it and correct for various problems, and does that and thinks of itself as approaching more and more the truth. But you might say this idea of a court of appeals is the wrong picture. And so to try to put this in a positive way, we could say, yeah, science gains objectivity, to get back to that question, by being self-correcting. Not by resting on some foundation. Next time we're going to look at his arguments concerning looking green and being green, and concerning, you might say in general, what it is to endorse a claim as constituting knowledge.